I've been carried by grace. Don't ask me how, 'cause I can't explain. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I've got some blessings that I don't deserve. I've got some scars, but that's how you learn. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I think it over and it doesn't add up. I know it comes from above. I've got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles.
Hey guys, so today I'd like to do a video on the clinical correlates pertaining the anatomy of the head and neck, and this video would require prerequisite knowledge of the normal anatomy, right? So we're going to start from the exterior, that is your skull, then we get maybe to the scalp, then the face. Then we'll end by talking about the spatial senses, that is vision, audition, olfaction, and gustation, right? So there's going to be a point known as the pterion on the lateral aspect of the skull, when you feel the skull from the norma lateralis. And this point will actually be the weakest point of the skull. And you're going to have four bones meeting there. That is the anterior inferior angle of the parietal bone, the squamous part of the temporal bone, the greater wing of the sphenoid, as well as your frontal bone. And if you're going to have fracture this weak site, you're going to have rupture of the anterior division of the medial meningeal artery. And if you're going to have rupture of this artery, you're going to have an extradural hematoma that is more likely going to compress on your precentral gyri, which is mainly motor. So you're actually going to have motor deficits persisting, right? You can actually have fracture or necrosis of the spine of the sphenoid. This will be clinically important because you have two nerves that are actually intimately related to the spine of the sphenoid, that is the auriculotemporal nerve on its lateral aspect and the caudal tympani on its medial aspect. Remember, the caudal tympani nerve will actually be carrying taste sensations from the anterior to that of the tongue, whilst the auriculotemporal nerve will actually be one of the posterior branches from the posterior division of the mandibular nerve, that is V3 trigeminal. And this auriculotemporal nerve will need to go and supply the parietal gland, as well as the skin of the scalp and the that is in the temporal region, as well as the auricle, right? So you may actually injure the auriculotemporal nerve and you have problems with the parietal gland. Then if you injure the caudal tympani, you're going to have problems with the submandibular and sublingual glands, right? Because these nerves, they carry secretory motor fibers to these glands. So you're going to have a decrease in salivation on top of the loss of taste sensations from the anterior to third of the tongue. Then when you look at a neonatal skull, you're going to find the fontanelles, and more importantly, the anterior fontanelle will actually be the largest, and it's going to be diamond shaped, and it's actually going to be used to test for hydration in a kid. Then you can have fractures of the mandible despite the fact that it's actually the strongest bone of the face, and the mandible tends to fracture at three sites, either at the neck, at the angle, or in the canine region, right? But the neck of the mandible is actually the weakest part of the bone if you look at it overally. Then if you look at fractures of the maxilla, they can be classified into three groups, but what are known as the L4 fractures, right? So you have what is known as L4-1, L4-2, and L4-3, right? In L4-1, this is a horizontal fracture that runs along the floor of the nose, above and parallel to the palate, right? Then if you look at L4-2, this is a pyramidal-shaped fracture line. It's going to pass through the root of the nose, the floor of the orbit, then runs medial to and below the zygomatic bones. But L4-3 now, This fracture runs through the root of the nose, superior orbital fissures, and lateral walls of the orbit, but it's actually going to be above the zygomatic bones, meaning to say the zygomatic bone will be the dividing landmark for those L4 fractures. Then you may have fracture of the former in all three types of L4. And if you fracture the former in those situations, you're going to have a deviated nasal septum, because remember the former will form the posterior most part of the bony nasal septum, with the anterior part actually being cartilaginous. Right. Then you can have mid-ear infections actually spreading into the mastoid antrum, causing mastoiditis and a mastoid abscess. Remember, within the mastoid process, you're going to have formation of mastoid A cells, and these are actually going to lie posterior to the mid-ear. Right. Then the bursosphenoid joint can actually be used to assess age of an individual. So this is actually a primary cartilaginous joint, but you're going to have hyaline cartilage between the bursa and the part of the occipital bone and that posterior aspect of the sphenoid bone. And if you look at it, this cartilaginous plate is completely replaced by bone by the age of 25. So that can be used to assess age, maybe in sports tournament and so forth. Then there is what is known as a craniopharyngeal canal, and this occasionally represents a remnant of Rathke's pouch. So remember, in development, the pituitary gland has both an ectodermal and a neuroectodermal region. The neuroectodermal region, that will actually be an outpouching of the diencephalon, will form the posterior part of it, whilst the anterior part of the gland will actually be formed from the stomodium, which is basically oral ectoderm. Right. So the observation of cellulitic and radiographs of skull is of great clinical importance, because pathological changes in it reflect intracranial space occupying lesions such as a pituitary tumor. Remember, the pituitary gland will actually be housed within that pituitary fossa in your sphenoid bone. Right? Then in cases of head injury, you can have blood-stained discharge of CSF from the nose, that will be known as cerebrospinal fluid rhinorrhea. Right? This actually indicates fracture of the cribriform plate of the ethmoid within the anterior cranial fossa of the skull. Right? And this can later on lead to anosmia, that is a total loss of smell. Then the lacrimal process of the inferior nasal conchae actually articulates with the margins of the nasal lacrimal groove of the maxilla, right, to form what is known as a nasal lacrimal canal. Right. So if you're going to have congenital lacrimal defects, you may actually surgically fracture the inferior nasal conchae to correct that. Then when you look at the bone of the neck, that is your hyoid bone, it's actually examined in cases of sudden death, because a fracture of a hyoid bone I can actually suggest maybe death by throttling or strangulation. Right? And there's what is known as a carotid tubercle, that is on the sixth cervical vertebra. The anterior tubercle of the transverse process of the sixth cervical vertebra is very large, and that is what we refer to as Chesnek's tubercle. And the common carotid artery can actually be compressed against it. And beyond this point, going upwards, the common carotid artery actually becomes superficial and you can feel its pulsations. And moving a bit deep, we'll then get to the scalp. Remember, the scalp will have five layers, that is from the exterior going inwards: skin, connective tissue, loose areola, the aponeurotic layer rather, then the loose areolar tissue, and then the pericardium. The first three layers are what I refer to as the surgical layers of the scalp. They actually refer to as the scalp proper. And the loose areolar tissue that is beneath actually provides or accounts for the free mobility of the scalp proper. Then there's something known as a black eye or raccoon's eyes. So if you look at it, if you're going to have blood or fluid collecting in the layer of loose areolar tissue, it's more likely going to trek towards the orbit, because the occipital frontalis muscle has no bony attachment anteriorly, as opposed to the occipital belly that are actually attached to bone posteriorly. Right. But this is not the only cause of a black eye. You can actually have a black eye developing from a direct blow maybe in fights or things like that. And this layer of lucellular tissue is actually referred to as the dangerous layer of the scalp because blood and pus freely tend to collect in this layer, right? And remember, they're actually what are known as emissary veins that are going to connect superficial veins to the intracranial venous sinuses, the dural venous sinuses. So you may have those infections passing retrogradely to the brain. Then fractures of the cranial vault in children may be associated with tearing of dura mater and pericranium. And in such cases, the blood from intracranial hemorrhage communicates with the subaponeurotic space of the scalp, right? And the signs of cerebral compression do not develop until the subaponeurotic space is actually fully filled. And this is what is referred to as the safety valve hematoma, right? Then, if you're going to have collection of cerebrospinal fluid within the subaponeurotic space, that is going to be referred to as a Kefauver-Hydrosil, right? And it's what is known as a Kefauver-Hematoma. This is subperiosteal collection of blood, basically. Then Caput-Cutaneum, that is a subcutaneous edema that is present delivery, right? And it takes place during the passage of the head through the birth canal, right? And if you interfere with venous return, you're more likely going to have a bulging or an edema on the forehead. And then the scalp wounds bleed profusely, but they actually heal quickly due to the fact that you have high vascularity. Remember, you have the supratrochlear, supraorbital, the superficial temporal vessels, the posterior auricular and the occipital artery actually supplying the scalp region, and those arteries are actually going to end by anastomosing, providing a pathway where the internal carotid and the external carotid arteries will actually anastomose with one another. And since they're going to bleed profusely because those blood vessels are found within the connective tissue layer, which is actually going to be dense connective tissue, when you then flip the wounds, they're actually going to heal quickly because you have high vascularity in this region. And since all the arteries are going to be coming from lower down, you can stop the bleeding by tying your forehead with the tight lace. And that is going to be the same situation when you look at the face. You're going to have a profuse blood supply in the region of the face, right? Therefore, it is rare in plastic surgery for skin flaps to necrose when you look at the face. Then, talking about the muscles of facial expression, there's going to be something known as crow's feet that is going to be as a result of the contraction of the entire orbicularis oculi muscle. The orbicularis oculi muscle will actually have three parts: the palpebral part that closes gently, an orbital part, and the lacrimal part. So this contraction is going to draw the skin of the forehead, the cheek, and the temple towards the lateral angle of the eye. And you're going to have something known as an crow's feet. Then there's something called ectropion. Ectropion is actually drooping of the lower eyelid. That is different from ptosis, which is drooping of the upper eyelid. That will not be a problem with the levator palpebrae superioris or the superior tarsal muscle that is actually innervated by sympathetic fibers. So if you have an ectropion due to injury of the oculomotor nerve, rather not the oculomotor, the facial nerve or the muscle, your orbicularis oculi, you are more likely going to have epiphora, that is continuous spilling or dribbling of tears onto the face. Then if you have paralysis of the sphincter of the mouth, which is the orbicularis oris. If you paralyze one half, that's going to prevent proper closure of the lips on that side. Consequently, the speech is slurred and the saliva escapes between the lips and the end of the mouth. So you have continuous dribbling of saliva from the lateral end of the mouth. Then if you paralyze the back sphincter muscle that is supplied by the buccal branch of the facial nerve, you're going to have collection of food within the vestibule. Then Bell's palsy is basically a lower motor neuron type of lesion. And you have paralysis of the facial muscles. So your facial asymmetry, loss of the horizontal wrinkles, widening of the palpebral fissure because you lose the orbicularis oculi. Tears flow down. I have talked about that. Then you have sagging of the angle of the mouth, loss of the nasolabial fovea because you actually paralyze a very important muscle that is really small though, and is the longest nerve in the body. That is the levator labii superioris alecanase. Then you have accumulation of food in the vestibule, dribbling of saliva from the angle of the mouth, loss of resistance, right? But in an upper motor neuron type of lesion, and that the pyramidal tract has dual innervation, right? The upper part of the face is not it's not affected. This part remains unaffected because the lower motor neuron supplying this part of the face receives cortical nuclear fibers from cerebral cortexes on both sides, right? So you actually only affect the lower part of the face, not the upper part. And there's something known as trigeminal neuralgia, and this is a clinical condition characterized by sudden paroxysmal attacks, and of the pain will last from a few days to several hours, right? And it commonly affects the maxillary nerve. Then there's something known as herpes zoster ophthalmicus. This is actually going to be a viral infection involving the ophthalmic nerve, and it presents as severe pain and edema in the ophthalmic territory. Then you can actually feel the pulsations of the facial artery at two different sites, base of the mandible and about 1.25 centimeters lateral to the angle of the mouth. Then there's what is known as the dangerous area of the face, right? And the facial vein and its communications are devoid of valves in their lumens, right? So since the facial vein rests directly on the muscle facial expression, the movements of these muscles actually facilitate a spread of septic emboli from an infected area of the lower part of the nose, the upper lip, and the adjoining regions of the cheek. In a retrograde manner, through what is known as the deep facial vein to the pterygoid venous plexus, then via the mesial vein, they go to the cavernous sinus, leading to meningitis. That is why this portion of the face is actually referred to as the dangerous area of the face. Ptosis, as I alluded to earlier on, it's actually drooping of the upper eyelid, and this is going to be due to paralysis of the levator palpebrae superioris following lesion of the oculomotor nerve, which actually supplies it. And there's what is known as a sty or a rhodiolum. This is a suppurative inflammation of the sebaceous gland, right? And in this condition, the gland will be swollen, hard, and painful. Then there's a chalazion, which is now inflammation of the meibomian gland, which is your tarsal gland. Then general inflammation of the eyelids will actually be known as blepharitis. Then inflammation of the conjunctiva, that is conjunctivitis, due to infection or an allergy is one of the commonest diseases of the eye. And trachoma is a granular conjunctivitis caused by the trachoma virus and is actually contagious and considered one of the commonest causes of blindness. That is, it is actually useful to examine the palpebral conjunctiva for anemia and the bulbar conjunctiva for jaundice. Then when you look at the removal of the entire lacrimal gland, that is not going to lead to dryness of the conjunctiva because it is kept moist by the secretions of your accessory lacrimal glands. Then epiphora is an overflow of tears. It can be caused by a lot of things, including drooping of the lower eyelid. You can have excessive secretion of tears, that's hyperlacrimation, or you may have obstruction within the lacrimal passages. Then going further deep, you'd find that infections of the retropharyngeal space can actually pass down behind the esophagus. They can actually get to the posterior mediastinum, right? As far down as the posterior mediastinum. And tubercular caries of the cervical vertebra can actually produce abscesses in the prevertebral space, which also often expand into the retropharyngeal space. Then there's going to be something known as a wry neck or torticollis. There's a clinical condition in which the head is bent to one side and the chin points to the opposite side. Right. This occurs due to spasms within the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscle, which are actually both supplied by the spinal accessory nerve, which is C1 to C5 in origin. And it can be congenital due to birth injury. It can be a reflex torticollis, that's irritation of the spinal accessory nerve. It can actually be spasmodic torticollis, this is characterized by repeated painful contractions of the trapezius and the sternocleidomastoid on one side. That is probably due to a maladjustment of the pillow during sleep. Then you can have a sternomastoid tumor, which is more or less a swelling in the middle third of the sternocleidomastoid due to edema or ischemic necrosis caused by birth trauma. Then the spinal accessory nerve may be damaged in operations involving the removal or biopsy of lymph nodes. Remember, when it actually courses within the posterior triangle, it's going to be associated with a group of lymph nodes. Then you can have a brachial plexus nerve block within the posterior triangle of the neck, because remember, you're going to find the roots and the trunks within that compartment. And pulsations of the subclavian artery, they can be felt at the root of the neck by pressing behind the clavicle. Right. Then you can have swelling in the posterior triangle, and the most commonest cause of swelling in the posterior triangle will be enlargement of nodes. They're what are known as supraclavicular lymph nodes, and those are enlarged in tuberculosis, Hodgkin's disease, and malignant growth of breast and lung cancer. The left supraclavicular lymph nodes will actually be important because they're known as the facial lymph nodes, and these are actually commonly involved in metastasis from cancer stomach, cancer testis, and cancer of the abdominal organ. Then infections on the floor of the mouth, the tip of the tongue, as well as the incisor tip in the midline will actually enlarge the submental lymph nodes that you're going to find within the submental triangle. Remember this, you're going to have an anterior triangle being divided into a submental, a submandibular, a carotid, and a muscular. The submental being the one that is between the hyoid bone, the anterior median line, and the anterior bit of the digastric muscle. Whilst the submandibular triangle, your digastric triangle, will actually exist between the two bellies of the digastric muscle and the lower border of the body of the mandible, whilst the carotid triangle will then exist between the posterior belly of the digastric and the sternocleidomastoid, as well as the superior belly of your omohyoid muscle, which is going to be one of the infrahyoid muscles. And then that submandibular triangle, that is a common site for swellings due to the fact that you have submandibular lymph nodes, you have a submandibular salivary gland as well. Then you can have neck rigidity in meningitis due to spasm of extensor muscles on the back of the neck. And infections of the parotid gland are commonly caused by mumps virus. This is going to cause inflammation and swelling of the gland. And those swellings, they're actually very painful due to the unyielding nature of the parotid capsule that is actually going to be covered within the infesting layer of deep cervical fascia that also infests the submandibular gland. So the infesting layer works in twos. It encloses two muscles, sternocleidomastoid and trapezius. It forms two fascial pulleys, one for the digastric muscles, then one for the omohyoid muscles. Then there's going to be something known as Frey syndrome or auriculotemporal nerve syndrome. And penetrating wounds within the parotid gland may actually damage this nerve and the great auricular nerves, right? And remember, the auriculotemporal nerve will be having parasympathetic fibers or secretomotor fibers that are actually going to be supplying this gland, and they'll be coming from the otic ganglion. And then the great auricular nerve will actually carry sensory and pseudomotor fibers. But when these nerves are cut during regeneration, your fibers can actually grow into the great auricular nerve. And when a person eats the ipsilateral cheek, will actually become red, hot, and painful instead of actually salivating. So this is what is known as gustatory sweating. then you can have development of hepatocyte abscess, and this may occur, and this may actually occur by spread of infection from the oral cavity. And it can then occur, it can then spread into the parapharyngeal spaces, right? Then you may have drainage of this parotid abscess, and this will be done by a preauricular incision, preauricular meaning in front of the auric of the ear, right? Then formation of calculi within the submandibular gland is actually more common than in the parotid duct, because the secretions of the submandibular gland are actually more viscid. Remember, it's actually a mixed gland, but it's mainly mucus. It's mainly serous rather, but it's also going to have mucus secretions, whilst the parotid gland is purely a serous gland. The instinct will actually be working against gravity. And you can actually have the swellings of the submandibular gland being palpated bimanually. Then there's something known as a ranula, and this is a large mucus retention cyst in the floor of the mouth arising from the sublingual salivary gland. Right. Then you can have an inferior alveolar nerve block. And this is one of the most commonest nerve block performed in dental procedures. You should also remember that the inferior alveolar nerve is the one that is going to give you the nerve to the mylohyoid muscle. And that nerve to the mylohyoid muscle will also supply the anterior belly of the digastric, with the posterior belly actually being derived from the second pharyngeal arc. So it's going to be innervated by the facial nerve. Then you can have referred pain from one branch of the mandibular nerve to the other. Right. So if someone is suffering from maybe tongue cancer, you can have pain in the ear or even in the temporal fossa, where you're going to be having auriculotemporal nerve supplying the skin over the temple. Right. So the pain is actually relieved by dividing your lingual nerve. Then you can have palpation of the TMJ joint and its associated muscle. To assess the viability of the joint, right? Then in terms of dislocation of the mandible, you'd find that the bone is only dislocated anteriorly, right? And to reduce the dislocation, the condyle must be lowered and pushed back behind the summit of the articular eminence and the articular fossa. Then temporomandibular joint syndrome. This is a syndrome that is going to consist of a group of symptoms arising from temporomandibular joints and their associated masticatory muscles. So you're going to have a diffuse facial pain due to the involvement of the masseter muscle, a headache due to spasm of the temporalis muscle, and then you're going to have jaw pain due to spasm of the lateral pterygoid muscle. Then those symptoms may be associated with clicking and pain in the joint. The clicking is often audible when the patient is chewing, right? And during TMJ surgeries, you need to preserve the facial nerve that will actually be traversing this region. And going further down to the thyroid and the parathyroid glands, you may have a thyroid tumor that is going to extend backwards. And if it extends backwards, its caps is actually thin on the posterior borders, and it's actually going to compress the nearby structures to include the trachea and the esophagus, then resulting in dysphagia and difficulties in breathing. And this thyroid gland, it actually moves up and down during swallowing. And its capsule is attached to the laryngeal cartilages, the hyoid bone. So they're also going to move up and down during swallowing as well. And there's something known as a goiter that is going to be an enlargement of the thyroid gland, except that during menstruation and lactation, right? That is known as a goiter. Then hypothyroidism occurs when there is insufficient T3 and T4, right? And those decreased levels of T3 and T4, they're going to cause a flux in TSH, and this hypothyroidism will then cause creatinism in children or myxedema in adults. You're going to be having edema in those lower extremities on top of other conditions. Then thyrotoxicosis or hyperthyroidism because you do an excess secretion of T3 and T4, right? These people actually have tachycardia, tremors, and so forth because this hormone is actually their hormones are actually metabolically active hormones. Then massive enlargement of the thyroid gland can cause dyspnea, that's difficulty in breathing. I talked about that dysphagia, as well as dysphonia, that is a hoarse voice. Then when you look at like thyroidectomy, there's going to be great care taken when you're actually cutting, because when you look at the superior thyroid artery and the external laryngeal nerve, they're going to diverge from each other near the apex, right? The artery lies superficial and the nerve lies deep, right? Therefore, the superior thyroid artery should be located as close to the apex of the thyroid lobe as possible, because it's moving away from the external laryngeal nerve rather. But the recurrent laryngeal nerve actually lies very close to the inferior thyroid artery near the base of the thyroid lobe. Therefore, during the same procedure, the inferior thyroid artery should be located away from the base of the thyroid, right, to avoid injuring the recurrent laryngeal nerves. Those two nerves will actually be going to the larynx. Then hypoparathyroidism may occur spontaneously or due to inadvertent removal of the parathyroid glands during thyroidectomy. Right. Then you can have hyperparathyroidism. Remember, the parathyroid gland is actually essential for life, and they're going to work in calcium metabolism. Then tracheostomy is a life-saving surgical procedure done in cases of laryngeal obstruction. And the tracheostomy is commonly done in the retrothyroid region after you displace the isthmus of the thyroid gland. Then Scalin syndrome consists of a group of signs and symptoms produced due to compression of the lower trunk of the brachial plexus and the subclavian arteries. So this, you're going to have thoracic inlet syndrome, basically. Right? You have a tingling sensation and numbness along the inner part of the forearm and the hand. That's the distribution of CH and T1 spinal nerves. Then you have progressive paresis and wasting of intrinsic muscles of the hand. Then you have ischemic pain, right? Then there's something called Horner syndrome. So you need sympathetic fibers in the head and neck, basically. Those fibers, they travel with arteries. Right? But if you injure the cervical sympathetic trunk, you're going to have partial ptosis due to paralysis of the smooth part of the levator palpebrae superioris muscle, which is your molar muscle. Then you have meiosis, that is constriction of the pupil due to paralysis of the dilator pupillae. Then anhidrosis, that is now loss of sweating on that side of the face due to loss of the pseudomotor and vasoconstrictor. Then you have increased temperature and redness, whilst anophthalmosis, that is a sunken eyeball, can actually also persist. Then you have loss of the ciliospinal reflex. That is, if you pinch the skin of the back of the neck, you're not going to have dilation of the pupil, which in a healthy patient takes place. Then moving on to the oral cavity, there's something known as gingivitis. That is, if you're going to have improper oral hygiene, this may cause inflammation of the gums. So this is gingivitis. You're going to have formation of pockets of pus between the teeth and the gums. And this is going to lead to pyorrhea. Right? Then in scurvy, due to deficiency of vitamin C, you can actually have the gums being swollen, spongy, and they may bleed when you actually touch them. And there's something known as tongue tie, whereby the frenulum can actually extend too far towards the tip of the tongue, right? And your tongue is actually going to be tethered to the floor of the oral cavity. That is also going to be referred to as ankylostosia, right? Then in Ludwig's angina, this is cellulitis of the floor of the mouth, usually due to infection from a carious molar tooth, right? then there's a rich anastomosis across the midline in terms of lymphatics on the posterior 1/3 of the tongue. Therefore, if you can have a cancer of the tongue on one side, it's going to readily metastasize to the ipsilateral as well as to the contralateral lymph nodes, right? But in cross, in contrast, there's going to be little communication between the lobes of the anterior 2/3, right? Then your nasopharyngeal nodes are actually prominent in children, and they're responsible for up until the age of 6, they're responsible for your adenoid formation. Then the piriform fossa are going to be dangerous sites for perforation by an endoscope. Remember, you're going to be having the quadrangular membrane medially and arytenoid fold. Then laterally, you have the thyroid cartilage and the thyroid membrane. And between those, you have what is known as a piriform fossa. It's actually a dangerous site for perforation by an endoscope. And a malignant tumor of the laryngopharynx may grow into the space. Then ingested foreign bodies, for example, fish bones and pins, are actually lodged into the piriform fossa. And if you don't take great care when you're actually removing those things, you may injure the internal laryngeal nerve, leading to anesthesia in the supraglottic part of the larynx, and you lose the protective cough reflex. Now, there's something known as a pharyngeal pouch. So if you look at the inferior constrictor muscle, it is two parts, the thyropharyngeus and the cricopharyngeus, which is the sphincteric part, right? And there's a potential gap between those two. That is what is known as the pharyngeal dimple, or K in stay sense. Then you can have acute tonsillitis, where since tonsils are the frequent sites of acute inflammation, especially in school-going children, it may affect the adult also. But this condition, that is your acute tonsillitis, you're going to have inflammation, commonly being a viral in nature. So you're going to have inflammation of the tonsils, and you can also have bleeding from the tonsillar fossa. That is going to be bounded by your palatoglossal and palatopharyngeal folds. You can also have bleeding in that that fossa. Then the pharyngeal tympanic tube, since it's going to open in the nasopharynx, it's going to provide a potential pathway through which infections can spread from the nasopharynx to the middle ear and vice versa. These are going to be common in children, since they're going to have a very short pharyngeal tympanic tube, also commonly known as the Eustachian tube. Then if you look at the soft palate, this can also be paralyzed if you have a lesion of the vagus nerve, and you're going to have nasal regurgitation of liquids, nasal twang, a flattening of the palatal arc, and you also have deviation of the ovula towards the opposite side. Then there's something known as a gag reflex. And if you look at the gag reflex and its two limbs, that are going to be glossopharyngeal, being the afferent limb, and the efferent limb actually going to be the vagus nerve. And injury to any one of those two can actually interfere with the gag reflex. Then there is something known as cleft palate and cleft lip, and that can be congenital. Cleft palate more common in females because their palatine shells, they actually fuse at a later stage, about a week after those in the male. Then a cleft lip is the more common one, and it's more common in males. Then the septum muscles of the larynx are actually going to be a posterior cricoarytenoid, because these are the only intrinsic muscles of the larynx which are actually going to abduct the vocal cords. The rest they adduct. And if you look at clinicals pertaining to nerve injury in the larynx, if you injure the external laryngeal nerve, there is some weakness of phonation because you lose the tightening effect of the cricothyroid muscle. The rest of the muscles, they're innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So if you then injure this recurrent laryngeal nerve during thyroidectomy, if you injure it unilaterally, the vocal cord on the affected side lies in a paramygian position. That is, it's going to be between abduction and adduction, right? But then the other one will actually compensate the sound produced by vocal cords Will actually still be a bit normal. But if you injure both on either side, that is bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve damage now. The vocal cords, both of them, they assume a pyramidian position and you lose phonation and you have difficulty in breathing. And if you injure both the recurrent laryngeal nerve and the external laryngeal nerve, the larynx then assumes what is known as the cataphatic position. There's something known as a Heimlich maneuver. If you guys have watched Miss Doubtfire growing up, Heimlich maneuver aims to expel contents that will actually be choking someone. Right? And there's something known as subclavian steel syndrome. That is, if you're going to have obstruction of the subclavian artery proximal to the origin of the vertebral artery, some of the amount of blood from the opposite vertebral artery will pass in a retrograde fashion to the subclavian artery of the affected side and go to the upper limb. So it's going to actually be stealing blood from the brain and taking it to the affected side. That's why it's a subclavian steel syndrome. Then you can have a cervical rib that can actually compress the structures that you're actually going to find in the thoracic inlet. Then there's something known as dysphagia lissoria. The right subclavian artery may actually sometimes come from the descending thoracic aorta and will then compress the esophagus, leading to difficulty in swallowing. Then you may have a deviated nasal septum. I talked about this when we're talking about lethal fractures, meaning to say you can have the former involved in those cases. And the deviated nasal septum mainly affects males as compared to females. And there's an area known as litus area where you have Kiesbeck and anastomosis. This is an area in the anterior inferior part of the nasal septum. It is highly vascularized and you have 5 arteries having their septal branches and anastomosis. That is anterior ethmoidal, sphenopalatine, greater palatine, superior labial, as well as the posterior ethmoidal arteries. An infection of paranasal air sinus is what is known as sinusitis. The frontal sinusitis is infection of the frontal air sinuses. This may spread posteriorly into the anterior cranial fossa, causing frontal lobe abscess. Then the maxillary sinus is the most commonly affected of all the sinuses because the infections can reach into the sinus from an infected nose. And it's the most dependent part to the excess as a reservoir, the spore drainage. Right. And pain from maxillary sinusitis is actually referred to the upper teeth and infraorbital skin due to common innervation by the maxillary nerve. The ethmoidal sinusitis is often associated with infection of other sinuses. The pain is localized over the bridge of the nose, medial angle of the eye. The only danger now is the ethmoidal sinuses are actually separated from the medial of the orbit only by a very thin plate of bone called the lamina papyracea. Right? So you can have a spread of infections from this ethmoidal sinus into the orbit. Then sphenoidal eye sinuses may actually end up affecting the pituitary gland and the optic chiasma, so you may have problems with hormone release and vision. Then the pinna can be involved and have to source off the geniculate ganglion that will be known as a Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. So if you look at the auricle on the anterior surface or on its lateral surface, it's actually going to be innervated by the auriculotemporal nerve in the superior to the third. The lower third will be innervated by the greater auricular nerve, whilst the conchae will actually be innervated by the Arnold's nerve, which is a branch of the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. And the eminentia conchae of the back will also be supplied by this auricular branch of the vagus nerve. But the lower third will be innervated by the greater auricular nerve. However, the upper two thirds will then be innervated by the less occipital nerve, which is a branch of, is actually a branch of your cervical complex of the neck, which is C2 to C4. Then to examine the external artery meatus and the tympanic membrane, the pinna is put upwards, backwards, and laterally in adults, but in children it's just put downwards and backwards. you may have perforation of the tympanic membrane, resulting from an external injury or a mid-ear infection, that is otitis media. And otitis media commonly affects children and infants because they have a short eustachian tube. And this can lead to spread of infections, and you can have an acute mastoiditis, meningitis. Please remember you have a thin tegmental tympani forming the roof. Then you can have a lower motor neuron type of facial palsy because you have the bony part, that is papillary of the facial canal, having both an oblique part and a vertical part. Then you can have cerebellar abscess if the infection spreads too far postoperatively. Then you can have hyperacusis if both the tensor tympani and stapedius being paralyzed. Something known as otosclerosis, that is abnormal ossification of the annular ligament that is supposed to anchor the foot plate to the oval window. And then you end up having conduction deafness. And referred pain for the ear, it actually goes to other areas supplied by the nerves that supply the ear that I mentioned. So that's the tongue, teeth, tonsil, and the pharynx. Then you can have strabismus. So you can have a medial squint, a lateral squint, a medial squint if you injure the abducens nerve that is supposed to innervate the abducens. The lateral rectus muscle. You can have an eye that looks down and out if you injure the oculomotor nerve. So you'll be left with superior oblique, which is to trochlea, and lateral rectus, which is to abducens. And if you injure the trochlear nerve, you have double vision, that's diplopia, when you look down. The central artery of the retina is an example of a typical end artery, and its damage will actually lead to total blindness. And the ophthalmic veins, they drain into the cavernous sinus and they communicate with extracranial veins. They actually provide a pathway through which infections can move from the extracranial cavity to the internal. Then you can have a corneal graft performed between unrelated individuals because the cornea generally is avascular. Then the corneal reflex is elicited clinically by gently touching the cornea with a wisp of cotton tool. And as the cornea is touched, both the eyes will then be closed. So you have the ophthalmic nerve being the afferent limb, the sensory fibers. Then they'll come back with the facial nerve now, which is the efferent limb that is going to innervate the sphincter of the eye, which is your orbicularis oculi. Then there's something called glaucoma. That is going to be poor drainage of the aqueous humor, right? Then presbyopia, that's short vision, and that's corrected by using a concave lens. Then you can have the lens becoming opaque. That's known as a cataract, and it can actually be congenital as well. And it can actually increase in incidence as you age. So that's just about it. I've tried to make it as short as possible, and I've left out some, but if you do have suggestions and additions, queries, or whatsoever, do feel free to comment. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and continuously watch the videos I repost.